Okay, without any further ado, I'll get underway. So welcome to Happiness is a Loud Gun. My name is Jason Cantor. I am in, I am a sound designer. I work for Avalanche Studios, where I'm an audio lead. We're right here in New York, so go Game Development New York. So yeah, this, as Zach mentioned before me, this is a look at the history of sound design for guns and film and games. So without any further ado, as you guys may recognize, this is indeed a gun, at least a picture of a gun. So you probably have in your mind a good sense of what this gun sounds like. How, just by show of hands, how many of you have actually fired a gun? Okay, that's like 7 or 8 people. How many have just been around the sound of gunfire, live gunfire, happen to be in the vicinity, maybe partaking in a bank robbery or something? All right, cool. So so less than half of you actually experienced the sound of live gunfire. But probably all, we all have in our minds what a gun sounds like. You'd probably have a good idea of what this gun would sound like if fired. So, guns have changed very little over the past 100 years. They all operate off the same basic principle. Small controlled explosion. Help. Can we get IT? Thank you. Yeah, that's what I was thinking. I think it's this thing. Yeah, this is just for me. Thank you, Alex. Alex Brandon, everyone. Yes, we got it. Thank you. Okay, so we're going to get off of this. There we are. Okay, so all guns operate off the same basic principle, which is a small controlled explosion occurs in the chamber, which propels the bullet down the barrel at a high velocity. In this regard, all guns are basically the same thing. Gun technology in this regard hasn't changed much over the last 100 years. Guns still operate this way. But the sound that we associate with guns has changed drastically thanks to film, media, and games, and television, which is how most of us have a sense of what a gun sounds like, since we haven't experienced the thing ourselves. So why has this happened? Why have the sound of guns changed over time? Mostly we can attribute it to, technological changes in film sound, where sound designers have more capabilities than they did generations previously. But for the most part, overwhelmingly, we can attribute it to being inspired by other sound designs, being inspired by the development and trends that happen in the art of sound design. So before I go any further, I should quickly define sound designer. The film industry has a very different definition of sound designer than the game industry. So when I say sound designer in this talk today, for clarity's sake, I'm referring to the game industry definition, which is somebody who creates sound effects. So this is a film sound timeline as it pertains to guns. As you can see, it's broken into three different eras. Each era basically focuses on a different aspect of gun sound style, an approach to gun sound style. As we delve into each one differently, I will take a look at, I'll be playing a video for you that will be comprised of film clips that feature guns of that era. My hope is that in hearing these sounds chronologically, you'll be able to pick up and recognize the differences between the different eras in terms of style and approach. Before I go any further, I should warn everyone here that since this will be guns, clips of guns being fired in films, there will be lots of gun violence. It's kind of par for the course. So if you are averse to this, you have the option to leave now or simply close your eyes as the clips play, but just need to be responsible. So the first era we'll take a look at is the end of silence. You're probably aware that film started as a purely visual medium. There wasn't any synchronized sound added to film until the 1930s. This is the first time that reliable formats were introduced to audiences. So this introduced a new role, the sound designer, to film. So this era basically saw that role attempting to figure out what its place was within the film production pipeline. They were battling a lot of primitive technologies of the time, and basically at the end of the day, they were just trying to do their best to make things sound real, to make a gun sound like a gun. So with that, we will play our first clip. I'll have to bear with me here, because since I'm running this off of Google, I'm just going to be a little bit behind the curtain, and so maybe it doesn't guide me too.
Hello, wait.
So hopefully you can hear the progression in the quality of sound over that period, as well as the difference in approach to the sound design itself. So moving forward, we have this next era, which I've titled the Age of Explosion. Basically, it saw a lot of improvements in terms of the tools that sound designers had to work with, as well as in terms of recording and creating sound, as well as the playback for audiences. Film sound technology improved over time, and the fidelity of sound playing on a film got better over the decades. So this enables sound designers to push the boundaries of what audiences came to expect a gun to sound like. So we have a situation where basically they've taken more creative liberties in terms of what a gun sound should be. This is also the era in which the term sound designer was first coined by Walter Murch, working on Apocalypse Now, I believe. And it was the introduction of audiences to Dolby surround format. So that was something interesting, more sound was kind of filling the theater. Overall, it was within this era is when the sound of the Hollywood gun was first truly defined. So if you take a listen to this.
Thank you.
to mention before we start. There's a clip coming up, Dirty Harry. The 44 Magnum sound in that film is considered by many sound designers even to this day to be one of the best gun sounds in the film ever. So, be on the lookout. Gives you a good sense of the sounds of the era. Moving right along, we'll come to the final era for film, major definition. Basically, the digital age brought on more tools, more technology available to sound designers. It basically enabled them to have a sense of creative freedom that they didn't have before. We hear in this era, sound designers sort of turning away from the larger-than-life Hollywood gun sounds of previous era. Basically, you hear the gun sound pendulum swinging in the other direction. It moves away from a big, booming Hollywood sound and goes to a more defined sound with character. So you'll hear this. A lot of people consider this to be more of an increased sense of realism to the gun sounds. And as we follow that arc through the era, you'll hear it go past realism into what can be considered hyper-realism, which is a shift away from the focus on the explosion of the gun and more on the mechanical aspects of the gunfire. It's a completely unrealistic perspective, but it's interesting to listen to, and when you have a scene with a lot of gunfire going on, it makes it easier to distinguish the different sounds of the guns. You can actually assign mechanical sounds to different characters and make them pop out in the gun shoot. This hyper-realism arc, you can hear it come to an end within this next clip. At the end, there's a scene from a gun shootout from G.I. Joe Retaliation or something like that. And the guns sound more like they're firing nails than bullets. It's pretty interesting. Also of note is the scene from Heat, which is considered by many to be one of the most realistic sound shootouts in Hollywood. So without any further ado. So there you have it. Hopefully you guys could hear the different styles of guns over the different eras of film. But what does this have to do with games, you're probably asking? I'm glad you asked that. So Here we have game audio timeline. It's obviously shorter. Games have been around for less time than film. But you can see I was able to break it into three different eras, and it will follow the same sort of course as film sound design. Game sound designers had to go through their own sets of growing pains, very similar to the sound designers of film. So jumping right into it, we have The Birth of the Blip. This is basically the introduction of the role of sound designer for games, because games are new. They need everybody on board. So it's basically game sound design as a craft, attempting to figure out what its place is in this new medium, within all the technical limitations that came along with games in the early years. I should just note, for our purposes today, I'll only be focusing on console games, really. So initially, game consoles had chipsets in them, and we'll get too technically into it, but basically to make a sound, you had to command one of these chipsets to send off either a tone or a burst of noise. So to create a gunshot, the sound designer, or more likely at the time, the programmer that was tasked with putting all the sounds into the game, had to send a command to the chip and tell the noise generator to get a burst of noise, which basically sounded like psh. At the end of the day, sound designers, the role of sound designer did become more defined over the course of this era, but at the end of the day, sound designers were really just any gunshot, just a burst of noise coming from the chip. Just gonna jump ahead a bit because it's a bit repetitive and running low on time. Sounds sounded very similar. Is it too loud for you guys, by the way? I could turn it down. Okay, good. The 90s brought us PCM. For those who don't know, pulse code modulations. Pulse code modulation is basically the standard for digital audio. It's what wave files, or how wave files are made. It's sampled sound. So we saw the introduction to pulse code modulation chips at the beginning of this era in the 90s. It started with 8-bit PCM chips on the Sega Genesis. Let's continue with the Super Nintendo. They had a better chipset. And then we finished with the PlayStation, the introduction of PlayStation, that brought us the first 16-44-1K capability, which is basically CD quality. So sound designers, this was a pretty significant step forward for game audio. And for sound designers, it was more or less the equivalent of going from working on from silent film to what we're known as talking sounds with film on them. Film with sound on them. Sorry. So we were still lacking in memory and voice count and digital signal processing power, but it was a huge step forward. They were given new creative freedoms because they could actually craft sounds in the studio and then play them back in the game for the first time. So the significance of this era really can't be overlooked.
Shotgun collected.
Oh.
on.
Love that last shot. Just so yeah, you know, you can hear that how much better gun sounds got over the course of that era alone. I remember as a child playing Resident Evil 3 and just being wild by wow, this gun actually sounds like a gun. This is amazing. So finally, we have next generation. So the introduction of the PS2 and the Xbox brought sound designers truly an increased sense of creative freedom, something they never had before. We got better tool sets, we had increased voice count, memory, digital signal processing. This all got better with each generation that went in. Despite the fact that there was this increase in fidelity with each generation, even at the beginning of the early 2000s, the sound, the gun sounds that went in were still respectable. They still stand up by today's standards. At this point, we sort of have, we've reached a kind of a fidelity plateau where really it's all on the sound designer in terms of what they do. They have the creative ability to do good work. It's up to them. They're not really limited so much by technology. Okay, so hopefully you could hear some different types of sounds in that last clip. In conclusion, comparing the two, gun sound design of games versus film, I think it's hard to look at games and say, yes, there are definitive trends in style over these periods. And I think that's for two main reasons. One being the game development is so very different than film development. Working on a film, typically a sound designer is on that film for a few months, maybe to a year. So, and game sound designers, on the other hand, if you are working on a AAA game project, a lot of times it's for 3 to 5 years. It can be a really long period of time. So film sound designers have more opportunities to try out different things, to be influenced by other films, other games, other medium. Whereas game sound designers, you kind of get locked into a silo to a certain extent fairly early on. Once your publisher approves of a certain set of gun sounds, you're not necessarily going to want to go and change all of them. So it's something that sound designers contend with. Also, the pure maturity of it. Film sound design, it plateaued in terms of fidelity back in the 70s, really. So you have almost 50 years of having creative freedom without thinking about technology that much. Whereas games, it's really been less than 20 years, like 15 to 20 years ago. So that's really the main differences. That's about it. Thank you guys very much. Thank you to Playcrafting for putting this awesome convention conference together. Do you guys have any questions? Anybody have anything to ask? Go ahead, Alex. Oh, Mark, I'm sorry. So you're asking in terms of game sound design, randomizing. I mean, it's sort of a question of personal taste. I mean, in terms of hyperrealism, that would give me an increased sense of variety. But really, it's just figuring out what the elements are. You don't want too much randomization in terms of making a gun sound, because it's not something that you necessarily want to draw the player's attention to every time a gun fires, because it's something that happens in the game a lot. So if it's constantly catching the player's ear, that can be a bit off-putting. So a lot of times it's not, you want some variety in there, but it's subtle variety, you know? So it will be to the, you know, the different scrapes, but you don't want completely different noises with, like, the image of what a hammer would sound like when it comes on the firing pin on a bullet. You don't necessarily want a lot of randomization, you just want kind of subtle variety to keep it sounding more fresh. Yes? Yeah, I mean, a lot of it depends on the budget of the project. You know, doing shoot gun reports is expensive. You're basically paying per bullet, so that gets very expensive very fast. It depends on the project's budget, and we do have a pretty substantial library of our own gun sound recordings. So we'll go there first, just because, you know, you want, there's a term in sound design known as fresh ingredients. You always want to make a dish with fresh ingredients, because you'll care about it more, it will sound better later, just because of the fidelity of everything. You can get everything to your taste rather than pulling from the library. But with that said, you know, you need a lot of variety for gun sounds, and you don't have everything necessarily. So real quick, no, the first, I've never come across that. It's an interesting question. I know that racing games will get that a lot, where, you know, if you've licensed Toyota, Ferrari, whatever brand in your racing game, you know, they want to make damn sure you're using their engines on their cars, because that's something they take great pride in. But guns, not so much, although it's, the question's been, or the idea's been put out there, that, like, hey, what if gun manufacturers attempted to sue you for using their gun sound without asking them, because that's their signature sound. I don't know if guns are that easily identified, but maybe not. The second, hard for me to say, I don't actually design a lot of the gun sounds for our games. I rely upon my sound designers to do that and the audio lead. So I'd have to ask my lead sound designer, Dominic, I don't know. Certainly metal strikes. Basically, you probably want to work with sounds that have nothing to do with the gun, because, you know, a real gun, when it fires, it doesn't make a lot of impressive sounds. Unless you're using a contact microphone on it, you're going to have a hard time picking that up and making a signature part of the gun sound. But usually you will start with the actual sound of a gun firing and sort of, you know, pair it back from there. And sort of layer in interesting sounds underneath it, interesting detail. Yes, Omar. Okay, so yeah, minigun real quick. How are we fixed for time? Okay, so let's try to get at it. Minigun from JC3, in terms of the actual sound design of it. Yes, I did get to go to Florida and record some guns with some interesting characters down there, as they have them in Florida with guns. There was a real live minigun in the field while we were recording, and I got to fire it, which was unbelievable. It makes this unholy sound, just like you wouldn't believe it. It's nothing like what most films have portrayed, because it's not like a shooty sound. It's like a haunting, like, whoa. It's really frightening and an amazing thing to perceive. And it's one of the things that they talk about when Marines and those who have used it in battle talk about. It's just like the sound it makes. It sort of initially at least it used to scare the enemy into hiding because it was so terrifying. But yeah, it's as horrible as guns are, it was an incredible experience. But, it was helpful for me, even though we didn't use very little of the recording of that minigun in JC3. It was helpful just to experience gun sounds, and it's something I want to impart to you. If you're designing something that exists and you're trying to replicate it, it's so valuable to go and experience it for yourself, just because it gives a sense of reality that you can pull from. You don't necessarily have to replicate that reality, but something at least to use as reference. And like, I would have never known the sound and experienced the sound that a minigun makes if I didn't go there to record it. So it was definitely helpful, and that allowed me to push my sound designers to go for it. So, all right, thank you very much, guys. I appreciate it. Oh, and if any of you guys are sound designers or just interested, or composers interested in audio, we have a local New York Facebook group that we run called New York City Game Audio, unless you get audio. So we do meetups monthly usually, and it's pretty casual and cool group of people, and some of the folks are here from there tonight. So join up and come on out. Thanks.